What's up, everybody? Troy Cartwright here. Welcome back to another episode of Tenure Town. We had a bunch of new people join the Tenure Town community last week, which you can do at tenuretown.com. Also, if you haven't, please give this podcast a follow on Apple Podcasts or Spotify Podcasts or subscribe on YouTube. And hey, I hope you have a great week. Thanks. Today's guest is my dear friend, Rob Baird. Rob is a songwriter and an artist who has had songs featured in the TV show Nashville and Yellowstone. We get a lot of questions on this podcast about, do I have to live in Nashville to have a career as a songwriter and as an artist? And Rob is somebody who can provide a lot of perspective on that question. He did spend some time in Nashville, signed to Carnival Music Publishing, but for the last 7 or 8 years, he has lived in Austin, Texas, and carved his own path out there. I love this guy, and I love this episode. I think you guys are going to love it too. So without further ado, here he is, Rob Baird. How you doing, man?
Good.
What's going on?
Just wrote a song.
Nice.
Yeah.
You been in town for a minute, or?
Dude, I was supposed to come in last night.
Yeah.
3 hour delay.
Said
I'm gonna cook a steak, come in early.
So you just took the AM.
Took the AM, had that big C23 slot with a guitar.
Oh.
Just checked that bad boy. I was like, I'm not doing this today.
Yeah. You didn't try and go A1 through 15, early bird?
Dude.
Sold out.
I've never seen that before.
Yeah, it happens. Yeah. It's when you wait too close.
Oh yeah. And that's no the option. And then like, I don't know. You know how it goes, man. You just kinda have to.
Yeah.
Just be like water.
I mean, I now just pay. As soon as I buy the ticket, oh. I pay the 20. So basically every flight add $40.
Oh, for sure.
There's no way I'm even saving money at this point.
Of course, I executed some plan. I was like, I'm a Delta guy now. And then.
They don't go where you want.
Yeah, I let Southwest slip a little bit. Didn't get A-list again. I'm like, what am I doing? Where's my allegiance?
Dude, I did the exact same thing. I don't have a buddy pass this year. Yeah. Immediately, it's been inconvenient.
Yeah.
So
I mean, this is what we do. I need that extra.
I know.
You know?
We need the Southwest, dude.
Do you check a guitar?
No, never.
Oh, because you even on a Delta flight, you can get it up there?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, I just always take it. I just make sure, you know, I'm bored and fast enough.
Gotcha.
Bored and high enough. New thing at the Nashville airport now. Have you flown back out of Nashville with a guitar yet?
They got the new machines.
You can't put them in the machine.
Dude, I went with, you know, those Carlton cases?
Yeah.
You know, they throw them off a roof.
Uh-huh.
They make them in Austin. They throw them off a roof and then somebody runs over it with a bulldozer and they hit it with a flamethrower.
And it
I'm like literally, that's their website. I'm like,
yeah.
Man, if they can do that, then hopefully they can take care of my 52 Epiphone.
Yeah. So you've just been checking it. Or at least you did
today.
Yeah,
I've been checking it and it's like bright green sparkles. It gets a lot of comments too. People are like, damn, look at that case. And I'm always like, I've really just put a magnet. It was half off. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. Nobody wants a green sparkly case.
Well, but I do. It's become on brand, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. A little sparkle. Oh. I normally start this thing off with the same question, which is, how long have you been in town? I guess in your case, how long were you in town?
That's a good case. Yeah, yeah. A good question. I got signed to Carnival when I was 21. I was still in college.
Okay.
I don't know if I'd recommend that to everybody, but maybe not.
Yeah.
So that was 2009.
Okay.
And I've lived here twice, I believe in 2015. And I was splitting time right after COVID. I guess that would be 21.
Yeah, you had an apartment here.
I did. That was a great phase of my life.
Yeah.
1990 F-150, dude.
Yes.
Goldie Hawn.
Yeah, you had the truck.
Yeah.
How long did you live here? Did you make it that time?
That was about 11 months.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
I was back and forth and on the road too.
Yeah.
But I've made 3 records here. Is that right? Yeah.
Okay. Gotcha.
Yeah.
So you did, when you signed your publishing deal, you said 2009, did you move here right away or did you wait a second?
No, I remember specifically what happened.
Okay.
The Eli Young Band was hot.
You know,
the Eli Young Band. Yeah. They were killing it in Texas.
Yeah.
And one of the guys from Carnival called me. I love Carnival. They were just, you know, they also just were just kind of like, yeah, we'll figure it out.
Yeah.
And they were just, they were like, oh man, maybe, maybe just move to Austin, see what it's like for a while. I was like, okay. They're like, we'll just bring you up like every other week.
Okay.
So I did that. And I stayed at the Best Western over there by the BMI building.
This is 2009?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I was writing songs at my like college, like hand-me-down desk from Pottery Barn.
Yeah.
Just making them up. No idea. You know
right.
what I mean?
No idea what you're doing.
No, completely. And I made this record called Blue Head Angels. And they liked it. And they were just like, yeah, you know, we'll give you an advance. And I was like, what is that? Yeah. And I convinced my dad had to go with me to the meeting because I was like still underage. He just sat in the corner and he was just like, we got out and he was like, just looked at me and he was like, I don't know, man. He's like, it's going to take a lot of hard earned luck for this to work out for you. And I was like, okay.
Yeah.
And he's like, but I guess, I mean, you don't have to get a real job for a minute.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I didn't really know how much money, you know, how that was going to work.
Right. Right.
Yeah. It was like a $5,000 advance. I was like, dude, I'm rich. Let's go.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, I'd stay at the Best Western, and Brent Cobb and Adam Hood had just signed.
Okay.
So all three of us were there.
Pretty good. At the Best Western?
Every time, yeah. They had like gold sheets.
Okay.
Yeah. It was something, man. And for like 3 years, I just came.
Yeah.
Would just write with like all my heroes.
Yep.
Have no idea what I was doing. Like, oh, hey, Barry Dean. And he'd just be like, who are you? It's so nice though, don't get me wrong, but yeah. Just like, okay.
I often wonder, like, in those situations, what the publishers are saying to these people to convince them to write with.
Oh yeah,
it can't be fun for them.
I mean, yeah, it takes a little convincing for me to write with someone these days,
right?
Not in a bad way, but I'm like, yeah, okay,
yeah, let's see what's going on.
I gotta like maybe listen to a track and be like, oh, I get it.
Yeah
But you know,
so all right, so you're writing with your heroes. And how's it going? Were you enjoying it?
Dude,
feel like you were getting better? And
I don't think. Well, there was. So I, you know, I'm getting out of college,
right?
And then Carnival was like, those guys were animals, like party animals.
Mm.
And I was just like thrown right into that. And I was like, wow, okay,
yeah.
Like, and no one warned me. Not to say that the. And it took me a while. Like I was trying to become a better writer and working on my tolerance at the same time. Yeah. Yeah. Which was pretty incredible. And I think I learned over the 3 years that I was going back and forth, I started to learn and kind of build a little community of people that I wanted to write with that were like my age, you know?
Yeah.
And meet more
people. Your crew, so to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And found some mentors, which was nice. And I don't know. I mean, it was all right before Bro Country hit, which in turn, I loved.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like when I heard... There was a time before, and then when Far George Line hit, like 2014,
yeah, something like that. I honestly, I don't.
Changed everything for me.
It changed everything for everyone.
Exactly, obviously. But like,
yeah,
you know, I'm trying to be this like singer songwriter, making records.
What was popping?
Side.
What was popping like 3 years before FGL? I don't remember. Was it like
Josh Turner?
I guess so. Yeah, it was like Keith Urban.
Yeah, which I'm always down with Keith Urban.
Oh, it was great.
Yeah,
but. Like, what I guess, was that when Eli Young Band?
Yeah, they were kind of going. They were getting big. You know, they had some hits and little ones. Miranda. I remember going to a lot of Miranda shows.
Yeah.
Man.
So, okay. So, but it was different.
It was a different world. I mean, it was still like poppy, but not like that.
Right.
And everything changed. I mean, I was writing with all these people that were on The Voice. I don't think they knew what to do with me. And so it was just getting like.
Yeah.
People right off The Voice, and then everybody just kept being like Dirt Roads, and I was like, okay, all right. And then I kind of identified what was happening. You know, it took me a couple weeks,
right?
And then I was like, okay. And then our friend Troy Johnson, Tracker,
yep,
he was like, hey man, you should come check out this private show they're doing,
okay,
like FGL's doing. So I went out to Franklin, and they were doing a show for like Samsung, and I roll through the back door. I mean, I have no expectations.
Yeah.
And T-Hub and BK, they take me in. They're very nice. They're like, what's up, dude? Let's be friends. And like, they had like a mountain of Fireball, as I remember, like literally, like just like, and they were kept changing shirts and getting ready. And then I was like, okay. And then they were like, you know, they're about to do their like prayer circle. And then I kind of, you know, stepped out of the room. I was trying to get out, you know, I don't want
to.
I don't need to be in the, but they were like, nah, dude, you're family tonight.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow. Okay. And they were like, thanking Samsung for the great gig and the Lord. And then I watched the show And I was like, this is insane. This is incredible. There's like cryo going off. All these Samsung executives are just losing their minds.
Yeah.
And then my deal was up for an option. And I walked in to the office the next day and I was like, I'm out. I like left all my stuff here, man.
Really?
It's like October 3rd. I remember. Yeah.
This is 2015 at this point?
Yeah, it was 2015.
You were just like, this is not for me.
Man, I was writing songs with Rustin Kelly, which is amazing.
Yeah.
And we had written some really great stuff that I ended up cutting.
Yeah.
But I was just like, I'm going to go try to figure out how to make a record and put it out on my own.
Yeah.
Which seemed insane at the time.
Right.
But it I'm glad insane. I did it, you know? I mean, that's when I kind of started. And I ended up calling my record label Hard Luck Recording Company after what my dad told me. When I walked out of that meeting.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And then, well, you know, made a record with BDP, our guy, Brian Douglas Phillips.
Oh, yeah.
And
great record.
In his garage. You know, it went from, you know.
It's a studio garage.
It's a real deal, but yeah.
Yeah.
It's really his ears that make great records.
Yes.
And that was a whole nother world.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Was it like, was it hard to leave? Like, because you, I guess you've kind of been living here full time.
Yeah.
What, few years?
Yep. Over a year. Man, I really wasn't getting anywhere with writing, like, I don't know if it was my mindset, but I was always trying to write for my records, and then I'd end up writing for other people. And
gotcha.
I was down. And I still look at, like, what I wrote back then on, like, my BMI thing.
Yeah,
and I'm
sure.
Oh, okay. I forgot about that.
Pretty good.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
But at the time, I was just really wanting to make records, man, and trying to figure out what I was trying to say.
Yeah.
And now I'm like back to writing commercial country with people. And
really?
I wrote a song with a DJ the other day and I was like, okay, it was awesome.
Yeah.
You know? And so I think I just had to get all of what I wanted to do out and get kind of that experience under my belt.
Yeah.
Before I was ready to like
do the thing.
Yeah. Give up the goat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, I don't know. I mean, I'm a like very experiential learner.
Yeah.
I got to learn. I just got to do it.
Totally.
Whatever I'm doing, like I can't just like be like, what would that be? I just got to like get in there, do it.
Yeah.
I'm going to learn a lot. I'm going to fail a lot.
That's the best part is failing. I think I just failed for 5 years and then I was like, well, I have nothing to lose by making a record on my own.
Yeah.
It's like, how's it going to get worse? You know, like we might as well just go for it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think failing with songwriting, I was just talking about this when I was writing today. It's like I feel a lot less precious about the songs. It's like, you know, you can write another one.
Yeah.
And if you go in, you're like, this has to be perfect. This idea.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't, you kind of squeeze it to death.
Yeah, you love it too much. Yeah, I remember right when I signed, it was like right, I had like had my record deal offer.
And was that like 2018?
Yeah.
Okay.
But I didn't, it like wasn't signed.
Yeah.
Okay.
I remember those days. We were talking a lot back
then.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And I had this song and somebody had pitched it. I think Charles Kelly was like making a solo record and somebody pitched this song and he wanted to cut it. And I was like, absolutely not. My song. I was so precious about it.
Yeah.
And I put it on my record and like it was fine. It
right.
did fine. But like I should have just been like, yeah, cut it. That would have been great for me.
Right.
That would have like helped me out a lot more.
Oh, yeah.
You know, but that's hard. Your songs are so precious to you when you first start writing too, because you like don't have that many.
Yeah. You got to earn every song too. Sometimes
yeah.
it takes months to be like, oh, I found this last piece of the puzzle.
Right. Yeah. yeah when you finally get like a good one, right. It's like if only 10% of what you're writing is good and you've only written 50 songs, you only have five good songs, so you need them.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I don't know who's to say what would have happened if Charles Kelly would have cut that song, you know, but who knows?
I mean, you know, you could have a
butterfly effect.
Yeah. You could have two houses.
Yeah.
Who knows? But then, do you need two houses?
I mean, I think that'd be pretty sick.
Yeah, it'd be cool. I could probably go to both of them.
Yeah.
Like, I like this one too. Yeah.
I'd love to have two houses. Lately, I've just been daydreaming. Like, I could tell I'm getting older because I'm like, you know what would be sick? If I had a Porsche.
I've seen this one play out before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think I'm going to do it, but.
You got to take the turn slow.
I see. Porsche, yeah. I've just been daydreaming about buying a Porsche. So I'm not even close to doing that, by the way. That's me recognizing.
I can't wait to see, this is like a boat. I can't wait to drive your Porsche.
Yeah.
Don't own one, but great to drive yours. Yeah.
So you did move to Austin and start making records. This is a weird question.
Okay, I'm ready.
I look at your career and I'm like, this dude is a huge success to me because he's doing exactly what he wants to be doing. And that is like a beautiful thing. You're doing it on your terms.
Yeah, like 90% of the time.
Yeah. You know? Do you feel that way? Do you feel like you accomplished what you wanted by moving to Austin and kind of doing it your own way?
Man, it goes back to like the learning thing. You mm-hmm. know, you can only do it if you experience it. And I figured out what works for me. Like the way I want to write songs, what I'm trying to say, a lot of that is like, it kind of just falls on me.
Yeah.
Like, I've got to figure out what I'm feeling and how to do that. And I needed more space, yeah. I think, than like writing every day. Mm. I mean, I think I've been like last week, I wrote four times last week, you know?
Yeah.
But at that time, I had to kind of figure it out, go road test it, and then, man, I had like major stage anxiety for the first 5 years of my career.
Really?
And I never really talked about it. And I don't even think I was smart enough to know what it was, but I was going on stage and I was like terrified, you know? And
during, right before, when did your...
Before, during,
the
afterwards.
Whole time.
I mean, you know, then get in the van and then drive like... You know, we did, you did it too, like a massive amount of van touring for like a very small amount of money.
Yeah.
And just seeing all kinds of different things. Like I played in Denver the other day and I was thinking about the last time I was in Denver, I drove the van through the night from Nebraska there and played for like $150. And I was like, well, this is better than that.
Yeah. That's progress.
Yeah. And so I've always... You know, I grew up in Memphis, so like Tennessee was pretty normal to me. Like I'd spent a lot of time. Like you grew up in Texas,
right?
And then when I went to TCU originally for ranch management, because I was like, yeah, hell yeah, brother.
Yeah,
you know, I grew up working on these ranches.
It's country, man.
Country as country can be.
Yeah,
but I knew, well, the artificial insemination class was like when I was like, I'm out. Like, dude, no, this is good. But yeah. I was playing at the Aardvark. It's like, you ever play there?
No, I never did, but that's like I'm sure it's not, is it gone? But it's in Fort Worth.
It's now a church, I think. Or,
okay.
Or maybe it's a restaurant. And they went from a club you could smoke cigarettes inside that if you had a piece of paper, you could get in to like a church, naturally, to like a restaurant.
Yeah, natural progression.
But I had found kind of a home in the Texas singer-songwriter world.
Yeah.
I really wasn't like working in the Texas country thing because we weren't like bar room. Like my songs aren't like, let's go to the honky tonk. But
yeah,
you know, the Hayes Carls of the world and.
Yeah, that like, I call them like dusty troubadour.
Yeah.
I don't know what to call that.
I'm as dusty as I want to be, but that's okay.
It's hard. It's hard to be. Yeah. It's hard to be dusty.
Yeah. I rolled around the parking lot before I got here, but you know, but when I moved back to Austin, it did. I don't know. Tennessee kind of seemed like, all right, I've been here and done this. And Austin and the whole Texas thing, there's a lot of opportunities there that I saw and felt like I built a community. And I knew that I could, I mean, 2 hours, I'm here.
Yeah.
And so it started to make sense to me. And then I knew that I could always make records here too.
Yeah.
This is pretty much the most world-class place to make records.
Yes. The baseline level of talent in Nashville is got to be higher than everywhere else. Yeah.
I mean, you ever met Brian Dolly? You know Brian Dolly?
No.
Brian's a good friend. I mean, he's worked with a lot of people, Rustin in particular. He's played on my records. We were just writing a track, and like, he literally had the whole thing going, and like, before I could even get the first lyric out.
Some of these people can do, like in the box.
Yeah.
Just, you know, even with like, that's not real drums. Yeah. It's like sample drums and sounds. It's incredible.
My guitar is still there. I didn't even get it out of the case. I was like, I'm coming back tomorrow. I can just leave it here. Yeah. He was like, oh, it's unbelievable.
Yeah. That's awesome.
So but I started really trying to build a touring career that worked for me.
Yeah.
You know, you can't take the band everywhere.
Right.
I mean, you can try. It's terrifying once you start really running numbers, as we talked
the
about.
The numbers are bad, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Even if you're winning, it's bad. In like a good 350, like you really got to hit all the things, you know?
Yes.
And so I think when I got out of Nashville, I went and played. I lived in my own back house. I have a little back house you spend some time in.
Yep.
Troy Johnson was living in the front house. So I kind of had like a little bit covered there.
Yeah.
And I played like 100 acoustic shows. And that's how I got over the stage fright.
Wow.
That's, I mean,
you just did it.
You just said like that was the only way. And I learned how to tell a story on stage or embrace a moment that's weird. You know, those are the best. When you catch somebody and you're like, what?
Yeah.
What are you talking about? And you can keep that going as like a thread line the whole time.
Yeah.
And kind of identified like who I was, why I was doing this, and what I wanted to do. And it wasn't, I mean, none of this is easy. It's never going to be easy in any way, any shape, form. I don't care if you're, I mean, one of the biggest acts in Nashville, you probably have a lot of different problems that I don't have. But I don't know if I want like to worry about my 6th tour bus breaking down.
Right.
But that sounds cool. Don't get me wrong. But then it goes back to the Porsche thing.
Right.
Like, you probably have a Porsche. You got 6 tour buses. Maybe you have a tour bus that pulls your Porsche to wherever you go.
You might.
Yeah.
You might.
Which would be cool.
Yeah.
But I just knew that I kind of had to like do this grassroots thing.
Yeah.
And it started to make sense eventually.
Yeah.
And then get fans and there's like some staying power and like keep making records and then having staple songs that people want to come hear.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, we had, episode hasn't come out yet, but we had Jason from the drummer for Flatland Cavalry come out.
Oh, yeah.
And we talked about the way that, you know, the way that the Nashville way of like making records is very much like make a hit.
Yeah.
You make a hit. It's like top of the funnel, everyone's into the hit. And then you can like build out based on the hit, right? You can like hammer it, get it number one on radio, get on, you know, direct support on the summer arena tour.
It's a system.
It's a system.
Yeah.
And it's and it, it if the system works for you, it's awesome.
Makes sense too for those acts and what you're doing.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But that's not the only way. And the other way is like the grassroots way. And, you know, talking about a band like Flatland, it's like they look at their records as like feeding the fans. So they play the live show and then every 18 months to 2 years, they, you know, put a little more food down for everybody to graze on. And, you know, you figure out which songs people fall in love with. And they, I mean, that's a thing you don't get to know.
Totally.
Always what people are going to fall in love with, what song is going to become another staple in the set. But yeah, eventually you get, you know, first it's 3, then you get it up to like 12, 15 songs. And then you're really, you're cooking.
Dude, I do think about that a lot. I'm like, you know, I'm sure this happens to you. Like the songs that I'm in love with, I mean, I have my staples. I've never had a problem being like, oh, I got to play Dreams and Gasoline again. I'm like, that song has done so much.
Yeah.
That song has saved me on like getting a TV placement and these little things. Like,
right.
Like it was just on some NASCAR thing. And they like sent me all this. They sent me like a lifetime pass to the NASCAR museum.
That's awesome.
And I was like, hell yeah. Yeah. Well, here we go. Sure. You know, and just the weird places music takes you. But I think when I get this is like a dream scenario, like a certain age. I think about like George Strait goes up there and sings his like 25 hits, or I know he's got more than that, but
yeah.
You know, I want to stand on stage and just go banger, 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 and like have no concessions about what,
right, you what know? You're playing or whatever.
And I think I get about two to three depending per record.
Yeah,
yeah. Where I'm like, okay, that when I play in front of a songwriter crowd thing, or I play in like, you know, the big theater thing, I'm like, these both work.
Yeah.
Band, no band. And then there's always a few songs that people come and like, why didn't you play that song? And I'm like, the 8th track off my first record.
Yeah.
Which is cool too. I'm like, okay.
Yeah. Oh, you're saying these are like people asking you why you should have played this song.
Yeah. I'll get some like, but I'm like, I have 7 records now.
Yeah.
So does that ever happen to you where you're like, You feel like you played your set and then somebody comes up to you and you're like, why did you not play that?
I'm trying to get better at like being open to that sort of thing. Yeah. Like this sounds sad, but it's, I don't mean it to be sad. Like you play for so long, you're just trying to get people to like tolerate you.
Yeah. I hear you, man. You tolerate yourself too.
So then you start playing these shows, you know, and like, I mean, we just started doing like headline hard ticket stuff for the first time in a while. Like we started this like last September.
Yeah.
Dude, it's hard. It's hard work. Man. It's so scary. You want to talk about anxiety? Every time I get to the show, I can barely function till we get on stage and I'm like, oh, there's people here.
Oh yeah.
Thank God. You know? Yeah. And but I've noticed now, for whatever reason, if it's just time and market or whatever, like people like these songs. People are attached to these, to certain songs that I have. And I am not like, I will tell you what's a horrible gauge is like Spotify stream count.
It doesn't matter
because
anymore, man.
I have a song called Technicolor that's like one of my most poorly, like, I don't know, poorly is the wrong word, but it's one of my lowest stream songs, especially right. Recent releases. Every show I play, somebody's like, why don't you play Technicolor? And I'm like, why? I guess I didn't know that anybody wanted to hear it. Because you lose. Okay, it still has like 400,000 streams or whatever. You lose so much in the
context of it all.
In the context, yeah. Like those metrics are really bad at providing you context. Like those songs, a song could have 10 streams and have impact.
I agree.
And
man.
I don't know how we're supposed to figure all this out all the time.
I think that was like, you know, when I started, just, I mean, were you selling CDs at one point?
Yeah. But like more for it to have something for people to buy.
Right.
Yeah.
It was 2010. Spotify didn't exist. It was like, here's your CD.
Yeah.
You know, and we were doing like, I was going to like Hastings and Amarillo.
Yeah.
There was one time we went out there and there was like two guys named the Bobs. Like yeah. Office Space, you know, it's yeah. a whole thing. But as Spotify emerged, of course, that's such a way to like look at numbers and all that.
Yeah.
I feel like in the last year, I mean, I used to check it every day. I think we used to talk about this too.
It's and not
you're,
good.
You're looking behind.
Don't look back.
And what's the point? And then now it's like, I probably check it like once a week just to make sure that like something hasn't fallen off a cliff. I mean, I also woke up one day and two of my records were removed from Spotify for 3 years, which was it was awful.
Yeah.
I guess Spotify didn't pay the mechanical licensing. That's a whole story, but yeah. We got through it. But like, yeah, I mean, that was like...
They were just gone.
Yeah, they were just grayed out. And nobody... I mean, I was emailing like Daniel Ek. Like, and he responded,
really,
which was insane.
Wow.
And Spotify was actually really good to me and... tried to like help me legally and all these things, but yeah, just to make sure everything's still rocking in there. Yeah. You know, things can go wrong, I guess, especially after that experience. But I don't, yeah, I just agree with the notion of like, hey, let me take my top 20 songs,
yeah,
put them on a set list, go try to sell hard tickets, and then not think about where I am, what am I doing, who wants to hear what,
yeah,
you know,
yeah. I mean, it's a puzzle piece to figure out for sure.
You're right, though, man. Hard tickets is, it's like we really, right after COVID, it was like, let's go.
Yeah.
And, you know, going to New York.
Yeah. I'll be there on Friday.
Oh, you're going to New York on Friday?
Yeah.
Awesome to play in the city.
Dude, I mean, but it's terrifying. We've
Absolutely.
Never played. The last time I played in New York was 2016.
I was there.
You were there. And it was like, it was the day after the election.
It was fun. Great time to play in New York.
Yeah, I mean, it was fascinating and like, yeah, man, I'm terrified, but yeah. I'm like excited to do it, and I don't know any other way to do any of this except to just like,
gotta get in there.
You just gotta get in there, and you gotta go see, and like, you know, we've had dates where we've sold not enough tickets,
yep.
And we've had dates where we've sold way more, and like. Look, the answer, like everything else, is like just keep going.
Yeah.
Go back.
Yeah.
We played Omaha, Nebraska, and sold like 180 tickets, and I'd never been there before.
What's up, Omaha?
Yeah. So you're like, okay, well, clearly something's working.
Yeah.
But you're just trying to constantly like listen and trying to find feedback loops that aren't so much like just looking at your Spotify numbers, right? It's like,
yeah,
I don't know. There's got to be a better way.
Why was Omaha? Do you know? Was there anything that you like figured out? I'm always trying to figure that out. I'm like,
me too.
You know?
No clue, dude.
No idea.
Never been there before.
Every once in a while, like I do my birthday show in Austin. I've been doing it for like 9 years and I'm lucky. Be careful what you wish for. You know, I was like 30 and I was like, yeah, let's do this. You know? Yeah. And then, you know, I'm 37. And you're like, well, okay.
Yeah.
But it's always like, it's a perfect time of year. It's January, like second week of January. Everybody's been cooped up.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, that'll work. That's a good one.
Mm.
And then it's like, hey, let's go to Denver on a Thursday. And they're like, it's the stock show and rodeo. And I'm like, well, I'm not exactly stock show rodeo. I might have almost got a ranch management degree, but I wouldn't say.
When you got, like, they play on Yellowstone and stuff. So I feel like
I think that's what they're thinking. And I was, you know, we had a good crowd, but I was literally like, there's an Airstream in the back.
Yeah.
And I was like, I kind of do this thing. With Laura, who works with me, and I'm like, don't tell me the exact ticket count until you know what I mean? Like, just keep me, like, how we doing, pump it. Like, I don't need to know if we sold 2 tickets to 20. I mean, tell me if we sold, like, 50 yesterday. But
yeah,
I don't, there's a barometer of what you really need.
Right, right, right.
Because I used to, back when I was, like, doing this all myself, like, every day you get that email, you know?
Yeah.
And it's just, some days it's zero. And you're like,
I know.
It's terrifying.
It's a bad feeling. But it is until you like just take it for what it is and it's like, cool.
Yeah.
We gotta keep just
hope the club books you again, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, man, I mean, since I left in 2015, so much has changed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and especially in the independent like country, Americana, whatever that means, world. And everybody kind of even the playing field.
Yeah.
In some ways.
A lot of ways.
Yeah. Which I love.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, when I was at Carnival, like the deal was like, we're selling CDs. We got a little distro deal, but you got to work up to the major, buddy. That's the only way. There's no other way you're going to get anywhere.
Right.
And so now, like, I mean, especially some of these young guys that I write with, they're like, yeah, dude, I got 2 songs on Spotify and TikTok's blown up, and I'm on the opening tour for... Yeah, 35 dates. And I'm like, have you ever played anywhere?
Yeah.
They're like, yeah, I've done some shows like at the fraternity house. I'm like, okay, go. Yeah,
I mean.
See what happens.
It can happen so fast. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know if it's sustainable. I don't know what is and what isn't sustainable, really.
You know, I think it's different. I think it's different for every artist. But I do think that like at the end of the day, I feel like the last 10 years was about consumption.
Yep.
Raw consumption. How many streams can we get on this song? And I think what you've seen with the artists that stick around is it's like, you know, you can't be this wide and just this deep.
Mm-mm.
You know, like the ones that stick around are like their fan bases are very deep. You know, and loyal, and that is a sturdy fan base, I would call it.
Yeah.
You know, and that's like, so how do you, once you can picture that, it's like, okay, well, how do I build that?
Yeah.
How do I build something that looks like that?
Right.
You know, and I still don't have the answer, but.
I'm still trying to make art, whether that art and commerce are old friends.
Mm.
But like, it has to mean something to me.
Yeah.
And I think if it doesn't mean anything to me, then why would it mean anything to anyone else?
Yeah.
And then how do you deepen that well if you're not trying to be yourself? And it seems it's easier to get to the people that want to hear you than it ever has been.
Yeah, I think that they can feel that. Just feel like that it's special to you. I mean, you're as long as you're making it for you and you like it.
Right.
That's it.
That's all you got.
That's all you can really control. There's stuff you can do. You can market stuff on TikTok or whatever. And like, it helps.
Yeah.
It's helped me out a ton.
Yeah. boost things.
Yeah.
Boost them on up.
Yeah. But, you know, at the end of the day, like, I just feel like I'm trying to focus on making something that I truly love. That, like, I compare it. This sounds like egotistical in some way, but I really don't mean it that way. I just think of it as like something that I like feel like I have to do. It's like, feel like I've been like taking little jump shots,
yeah,
little free throws, and that's been great for me. It's allowed me to like provide, make a living for myself making music. But it's like, I really want to take an arrow and pull all the way back and like try and make something like for all time.
Oh yeah, your wildflowers.
That's just like, yeah, this is like, feels like my life purpose to make this record. And like, it's like becoming so much harder than I thought, because I thought this year, you know, you're like, oh, it's almost done, but it's like an onion. You peel back one layer, you're like, oh, it
gets different.
There's more
changes.
And then you got to go, well, I got to go deeper. Mm-hmm. This song isn't going to work. I need another song. And then, you know, you go do that, and then you find another thing, and it's like all these layers, like, I might be insane. I don't know how long this thing's going to take me.
Oh, yeah. Is this your, like, secret record?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But, like, I've, like, scrapped the whole... I've, like, not started over, but I've, like, taken half of it, and I'm, like, just, like, I just got to keep going. And I have no idea, like, what it's for. I don't know when it's supposed to come out. I don't know what's supposed to happen, but I just know... Try not to sound insane, but it's like, I feel like the universe is, like, keep going.
Oh yeah.
You gotta do, just keep go deeper, go deeper. And so I am, and I'm like waking up at 4:30 in the morning going, am I insane?
Dude, that's every record I make. I mean, I've had a record in the can for like at least 7 months, yeah, which I remixed at one point.
Yeah.
Like, you know, that was cost. Like,
yeah, it's just, yeah, stuff gets expensive, oh, especially, yeah, when you're paying for all this stuff yourself.
And like, you know, you go in, you're like, oh, I'm good, everything's good, you don't, yeah, worry about it, and then one little thing happens. I made a song for a record that I made during COVID called Anthems Here. Mm-hmm. And it was probably one of the songs that meant the most to me and like what I'd gone through. And I ended up not putting it on a record, on that record.
Okay.
And then I released it and there was like a snafu with the distribution company. Okay. Like we had pulled it back. Something, you know, something good starts to happen. You're like, wait a second, we'll push a couple weeks.
Yeah, let's let this one cook.
Let's let it cook for a second. Yeah. And so I did, like, from that point, I had put out this record, Anthems. I went to Memphis and made another, like, kind of a re-record of all these songs with the same band. And so for, like, 2 years, I put a song out.
Yeah.
Like, every month. And then, you know, it's a give and take. You pull one back, and sometimes you're like, oh, maybe we'll do 5 weeks here. Or maybe it's, oh, 3 weeks here.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I had done that, but they got the confirmation and everything.
Yeah.
It still came out.
Oh, the song just dropped, mm-hmm, unannounced.
Just right on my, like, talk about 4:30 in the morning. I like saw somebody like in Europe be like, we love Rob's new song. And I was like, wait a second.
What?
And I can't do anything about it.
Yeah.
And so eventually I took it down, or I took it down immediately and then tried to put it back out. But you know, when you do that, you can't repitch. And so this song kind of went into oblivion.
Yeah.
And it's like really personal. And I'm like, you know, I was bummed out.
Yeah, yeah. Feels like you lit it on fire and it, yeah, you burned it, basically.
And like the track's great.
Yeah.
And so right before I was going to master this record, a friend of mine hits me up. This is all in 24 hours. And it's like, hey, man, where did this song come from? Because, you know, it just got buried.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, you like it? That's great. And then my friend Griff, who's a manager, calls me and he's like, hey, man, what's this song? Where did this come from? And then that night, another manager FaceTimed me with Chase Rice, and they were like, what's up, dude? We love this song. And this guy's like, I've been listening to this song on repeat. And Chase is like, I keep going to sleep to this song, man. I love it. And then, wow, the next day I'm like, I call, some reason I'm, for, I don't know how this is possible, but it's not that expensive to master at Abbey Road.
Yeah.
And so I was mastering Abbey Road. Like, you can't get in touch with him. You got to call him. And I'm like, hey, hold on a second.
Yeah.
And I mixed it, added it to the record.
Yeah.
And then I reached out to Rustin. I was like, oh, it'd be cool if he was on this song because I think he like identifies with what's going on. And then like 2 months later, he gets back to me.
Yeah.
Very Rustin.
Yeah.
And he's like, hey, yeah, I'm going to sing on it. And now it's like on the record.
Wow.
It makes so much more sense and fits in perfectly.
Yeah.
And like.
And you had all these random opportunities come from.
And I got to go write with Chase. And like I wrote a song and he had a buffalo herd, which is amazing. He was very fascinated by why I was fascinated by the buffalo herd. And I was like, what's the maintenance on this thing?
Yeah. Is it a tax write off?
Yeah. And he like cut it in like 2 weeks.
Wow.
And I'm like, all these things happened.
Yeah.
Because that one thing went wrong.
Right.
And it's crazy. And like, it definitely made my record better.
Yeah. And just like it adds to the, to like the like spider web of your career.
Never know.
You'd never know, dude. Yeah. You got all these intersecting lines and like all of a sudden, I mean, that's the tough thing about the music business, man. It's like you can go years and feel like nothing's happened.
I know.
And you're like, what am I doing?
But so much as little things are happening, you know?
Yeah. And then one day, you know, yeah, a bunch of stuff happens all at once.
I think what my biggest, like I started the year and I'm like, all right, where are you at? What are you doing? Yeah. What's the goal, you know?
Yeah.
And I felt pretty good about last year.
Yeah.
Especially before I looked, like, I didn't want to, again, didn't want to know the numbers. And then, you know, I got them and I was like, okay, everything, like, what are your expectations? Like, where are you going?
Yeah.
But as I started this year, I'm like, I enjoy writing songs more than I ever have.
Mm.
And I don't care, especially now, if that song's for me, if that song's for an artist, if that song's for a DJ, like whatever you're doing.
Yeah.
Those are the best hours of my week.
Hmm.
You know, it's the bonding with a person that you're writing with. Yeah. It's kind of like turning your phone over and going like, that is not important.
Right.
This is important. And finding something new. I wrote a little song last Friday. I think I played it. I printed the lyrics off. I put it on like my like little table in my living room. And yeah. I think I played it 35 times at least.
Wow.
Over and over, just like, and I'm like, every word, it works. I'm like, yeah. This is great. And I'm like, this is my life.
Yeah.
I feel like this is what I was trying to go for.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Dude, that's the thing, man. That being there's nothing more special than being in a writer room and just like, I'm so protective of the time now.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm in there, I'm like, do not disturb.
Oh yeah.
If like my wife's texting me, I'm like, are you dying?
Yeah.
No?
Yeah.
All right. We got to talk about it later. Like, I just can't. So many times I took it for granted. You're just in there like scrolling Twitter.
Oh yeah.
Like, what am I doing?
Right.
Why am I not present in this? Like 10 years ago, like I would have killed somebody to be in this room right now, and yeah. I'm not even appreciating it. So I've tried to like completely, you know, I've got a very deep appreciation for it now, a lot of respect for it. And I feel the same way when I'm on the road, like even bad shows.
I know.
I'll be loading up the van. We were playing in Kansas City and, you know, like it was a Thursday night. I was sick, could barely sing. Like turnout was kind of light. And I got back in the van and I was sitting there and I was like, oh, I love this shit.
Yeah.
I was just like, yeah. Dude, I love it. It
makes you feel like alive. You know what I mean?
Yeah, man. It's the risk. You're just taking a risk every day. And I just, I love it, man. I really do.
Dude, I was coming over here, you know, as I said, I'm in like the back of the plane or whatever, but my just sobering for me in many ways.
Yeah.
But I'm like, well, at least I worked hard enough for this.
Thought we would have been A-list by now.
Yeah, I got 2 Southwest credit cards. I mean, come on, man. But my sister's like best friend's husband was on the flight.
Okay.
And like, we're buddies. I see him at the gym.
Yeah.
You know, and he saved me a seat. He was going to Columbus, Ohio to like try to sell them on like wind energy. And I was like, yeah. How often do you do this? He's like, every other week. I'm in Columbus for 4 days. Mm. I'm like, you got a 6-year-old and a 3-year-old.
Mm.
I was like, he's like, so what are you doing? And I was like, I'm going to go write songs for 4 days. And he's like, how? And I was like, yeah, we'll probably have like a song by like 2. He's like, today? He's like, just the lyrics or the words? And I'm like, not like all of it.
All of it. The whole thing.
Yeah. And he's just like, huh.
Yeah.
I'm like, was there anything great in Columbus? No offense to Columbus. He's like, there's a great dive bar.
Yeah.
It's like, that's what you're living for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sure Columbus has a lot of charm, but.
Love a good dive bar. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But, you know.
Yeah. It's just
different.
It's very different. It's a whole different thing. And yeah, man, I really do like, I mean, I'd never take it for granted. You know, yeah. I think about the weird road that I've taken, that we've all taken, and it's just like, couldn't change it, dude.
Shows are fun, man. The only shows that get me, like every once in a while I'll do a private.
Yeah.
And like, I'll show up. I mean, and it all look good. And of course it pays well. So, I mean, you know, take it day. But no one will even acknowledge you. And that I've done a lot of those to get down the road. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's weird.
That's the one you're like, why? You should have let me DJ. That would have been amazing.
You should start offering that as part of the package.
Thinking about it.
Yeah.
You know, what package do you need? The country and western? The hip hop? Let's go. Bring in some Memphis beats.
Yeah. Well, dude, before we get out of here, do you have, you're talking to a younger Rob Baird.
Okay.
What kind of advice would you give him?
I mean, I think a piece of advice that I've gotten in the past 2 years is from my dear friend, Amy Lombardi. She was like, look, you got to get comfortable with being uncomfortable. Mm. That's the only way you can grow. And if you're not pushing yourself, whether that be writing, playing shows, hard ticket dates, whatever those things are, you just got to just bite the bullet.
Yeah.
And on the other side of that, my dad's advice always is, which is what we've been talking about, is have fun.
Hmm.
No matter if it does, I think you're not trying to sell wind energy, you know, or you're whatever.
You're not sitting in a cubicle.
Yeah. You got to have fun, whether that's writing songs or playing shows. I mean, I still love going into venues and being like, we get to play here.
Yeah.
You know, these are places that I grew up. I've always been fascinated. I think we've talked about this before, like just watching the industry, like as a kid.
Yeah.
And like, I mean, I used to know who everybody's agents were when I was like 16 and be like, they write for this company and they're signed to this and all these things and what venues they're playing across the country. And like, now I'm just standing in one of their green rooms and being like, this is ridiculous. And it's so great, you know?
Yeah.
Whether they're old and crusty and cool or I played this place in San Antonio that was literally the first night they ever done a show. It was brand new.
Yeah.
Have you heard the sound of a new PA lately? It is like being touched by God's voice. It was insane. I was like, wow, like this is brand new. Like the monitors are tiny.
Yeah.
Like all these things that you're just like.
A lot of innovation in live sound.
Yeah, it's amazing. But you think about it.
Yeah.
Club Harvey doesn't get a new PA for 15 years, maybe 20 years.
Yeah.
Nobody's like, all right, let's just switch out the multi-billion-dollar PA now.
Yeah.
So that's always fun. And just, I think that and whoever's around you, especially if you're like in a band.
Yeah.
That is huge.
Yeah.
It's very important.
Yeah. Who you with, who you're spending time with. That's the big thing, man.
And it can go wrong quickly.
Yes.
One guy just goes rogue.
All right, Rob.
Thanks, buddy,
for being here. That's it. That's the pod. See you later.